at skynews.com.au. I'm Peter Switzer. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next week.
When I casually remarked that Cadel Evans wasn't a hero, the flood of abuse was amazing.
Loser.
Ignorant.
Typical female.
And the most common insult?
You're un-Australian.
Really? Is it un-Australian to question the way we worship sports stars? I'm not anti-sport. Good on Cadel. But many did agree with me. And this is a fascinating new window into the way we see ourselves and what we idolise. What do you think? Am I right or wrong? Join the conversation when Mamma Mia returns tonight on Sky News.
The information featured in this program is general in nature and therefore should not be relied upon. Guests appearing on the program may have commercial arrangements with some of the companies mentioned. Before making any investment, insurance or financial planning decisions, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you.
Good evening and welcome to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Chris Gray. On tonight's property edition of Your Money, Your Call, the 12 steps to making the most out of the property market right now. Is location, location, location really the most important rule? And is it time in the market or timing the market that's made and misplaced millions? Also on tonight's show, the latest thoughts on fixed and variable rates and what's predicted to rise or fall. And one big switch, can consumers really take on the banks and win? Joining us on our panel of experts tonight is John Mansomelli of Mortgage Choice and Nicole Peterson-McKinnon of Smart Investor Magazine. So if you've got a question about whether it's the right time to get into the property market or anything to do with financing for properties, then give us a call on 1300 30 34 35, or if you prefer, send us an email to property@skynews.com.au. Welcome to the show and welcome to you guys.
Thanks very much.
Nicole, we'll start off with you. Tell us all about Smart Investor Magazine.
Okay, so Smart Investor Magazine is a magazine for retail investors that's produced by the Australian Financial Review. So we've got one of the best teams in the country in terms of the expertise, and our current issue that's on sale at the moment, we've got a dream property discount price cover story. And that's really a reflection of the fact that the property market is struggling, it is soft at the moment, so there are opportunities emerging.
Yep, and certainly we're going to talk through some of those tips this evening. And are you covering property and shares in there? So the whole mix of investments?
Yes, we are, absolutely. So it's a very much a holistic look at a portfolio in terms of all the asset classes and what's appropriate for your own risk profile, particularly in these very volatile signs at times across all the assets, really.
Yeah. So we're not going to cover specific stocks or anything like that, but if viewers have got questions to talk to you a bit about share investing versus property investing, then maybe something to call out.
Absolutely, and particularly the market jitters that have been happening today. I mean, you know, anything they want to know about.
Jitters, we're talking pretty big jitters, aren't we?
jitters euphemistically, absolutely, yeah. So obviously, tough times.
Yep. Okay, John, welcome back again.
Thank you.
Interest rates. I gather day by day it's kind of choppy and changing. What's happening, what's rising, what's falling? What are your thoughts at the moment?
What an amazing time we are in at the moment, Chris. Wasn't it just 3 months ago the economists were predicting 3 rate rises, and then we've got one Westpac economist saying it's going to go down. After today, I think it's going to go down significantly. I don't think anyone really knows, Chris. What I do know is that you just got to tailor it to your personal situation. What I'm seeing in the marketplace at the moment is a lot of people are staying variable. In fact, our Mortgage Choice surveys are saying it's staying variable. However, if history repeats itself, I suggest that there may be some opportunities to lock in. And there are some fantastic rates if you do want to lock in right now anyway.
Yeah.
The main thing, though, is to make sure that the loan that you're getting is tailored to your personal needs. So keep going back to that situation. So if you're going to stress out and you're worried about repayments, then maybe you should consider fixing. But if you don't, if you're not worried, then yeah, interest rates, the way they are going at the moment, there's just an unbelievably competitive market out there. I love seeing what's going on, so.
And that's the thing, there's always a silver lining with all the clouds, so you've got to look for opportunities all the time. Now, obviously around the Financial Review, there's a lot of clever people around there. What are they all talking about with regards to interest rates?
Yeah, look, I mean, today, as of today, and the Reserve Bank quarterly statement that's come out today, very much that rates are going to be cut. There's actually, the market is pricing in a 75% chance that the next rate cut next month is going to be 50 basis points. So that's really turned around quite significantly from even last week.
And that's literally in the last 24 or 48 hours or so.
That's literally, yeah, on the basis of that statement by the Reserve Bank today, and also what's happened to markets over the last 3 days, but today in particular, the expectations are very much for them to be cut now to really try and stave off what looks potentially like becoming global financial crisis mark two if significant action isn't taken.
Now, obviously with your magazine, you're looking at shares and property. When the share market takes a tumble, and it's taken quite a few over the last few years, is that generally seen as positive news for the property market, kind of within reason?
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? I think perhaps that used to be the case, but I guess with what we've seen with the world, you know, almost falling off a financial cliff a couple of years ago and us sort of crawling our way back up, is that confidence in a lot of the asset classes have been undermined. Because while property has withstood that very well here, it's only recently that it started to soften a little bit, it has really got rid of that idea that property doesn't fall. Because you saw what happened in the US and you saw what happened in the UK, where the falls were as much as 50%. So I think people are more cautious, which is a good thing.
Yep. John, in terms of the lenders at the moment, are they all getting on with each other these days, fighting, or what are they up to?
Isn't it beautiful to watch, Chris, seeing all this infighting going on? Look, it's a wonderful time to be a consumer of mortgages. I've never seen so much intense competition. They're throwing everything at the consumer of mortgage products. And the good news is, if you use this market to your advantage, you can get amazing offers being thrown at you, not just interest rate discounts, but even some lenders are saying, we'll pay for you to move to us. And in the 8 years I've been doing this, I've never seen that before. So wonderful opportunities to capitalise on that sort of environment at the moment. And also, I'm very encouraged to see this competition because it brings innovation in home loan products. What we're forgetting is, over the last 4 years or so, there's been no innovation in home loan products. There's some things, some wonderful mortgage products that are available overseas that we're not seeing here. So everyone focuses on rates, but let's get innovation happening as well.
Now, I don't know if this is innovation, but there's something that was reported in the media recently about One Big Switch. Do you want to explain to the viewers exactly what it is and what your thoughts are on that?
Yeah, okay. So for those viewers who don't know what One Big Switch is, it's a movement that's been created by Choice Magazine and another broker, where they're encouraging people to sign up for a campaign where there's a group buying activity. So I think there's roughly 10,000 or so individuals right now, Chris, who've signed up. And the whole idea is that there is a bulk buying opportunity. Now, I've got some concerns about this because whilst interest rates are important, I would argue that loan features are just as important. So are the potential loans that you're going to switch from going to give you the interest-only loan that you're looking for? Is it going to give you the redraw facility that you may be needing? Is a maternity holiday repayment period important to you? So I would encourage anyone to talk to a professional mortgage broker who will give you a very personalised consultation and get you a properly tailored home loan to your needs. So I encourage competition. I think it's a great thing. Anything that does to encourage competition is great. But let's not forget, this is a movement that is still still for profit. It's not a non-for-profit movement.
Because Choice is always seen as the independent organisation that's looking after consumers, isn't it?
They're getting paid for this. And don't forget, there's a broker behind this movement who's also getting paid for this as well. So at the end of the day, just speak one-on-one with a mortgage broker who can tailor a loan to your needs.
Yeah. What are your thoughts, Nicole?
It's an interesting one, Chris, because there was actually a service that was launched 3 weeks before it called Rate Alert by Ziggy Bid. Now, it's a similar sort of deal when they're trying to get a bulk of people to sign up to really broker this great deal they're hoping for, similar to the group buying sites that we've seen become so popular. Now, Rate Alert is disclosing very clearly that it's a 0.1% commission upfront and a 0.1% commission trailing after that. So it's all very clear, it's all up front. I think with the Choice One Big Switch campaign, they don't yet know what it's going to be. They don't yet know who the provider might be. They don't yet know the numbers they're going to get. They don't know the pricing structure. But certainly they've come out and said, look, we are for profit. We do need to cover our costs. What we don't know is what cover our costs means at this point. But certainly there will be some form of commission in there. So you do have to ask how independent that means that they truly are.
Yep.
How unbiased advice that is. Yeah,
that's exactly right. So it's a tricky one for Choice because they do have this fantastic reputation as independent. So just remains to be seen how this will be construed down the track.
And look, certainly for a lot of the viewers out there, then all of the brokers that we do get, and also the banks that come on the show, quite often it's not all about interest rate. Everyone's always looking at that as the main thing, but certainly for me, it's more about borrowing capacity. If I can buy more properties with one company rather than another, that's one of my main things. So you've always got to look at the bigger picture. Now we'll jump to an email, and we've got an email from Andrew, and he says, I need some guidance on where to buy right now for $400,000 to $450,000. Because my cash flow is already stretched, I can't afford a negatively geared property, so I need a return over 6% and need a property that will provide strong capital growth over the next 10 years when I plan to retire. Now, I've been thinking about trying to buy a dual income property, i.e. a house with a granny flat, as that will solve the cash flow issue. However, do properties such as these grow as much as other houses in the same suburb? Also, where do you think is a good place for me to start searching for this elusive property? I live in Sydney and not adverse to investing in other states. Very good question there, and certainly we've covered granny flats on the show a couple of weeks ago. What are your thoughts, John?
Andrew, I think firstly, I think it's great that you're thinking like this. Rather than thinking I can't do this, it's really great to see that you're trying to work around this and solve the issues. I can't comment as a mortgage broker where to buy, but there is reasons to suggest that Sydney and southeast Queensland are the areas to be looking at. In terms of financing techniques, I want to perhaps raise a few things that you may not be aware of that can help with your cash flow issues. So firstly, interest only may be an option for you, where it'll lower the repayment significantly. So rather than trying to pay off the loan, by having interest only loan, you're going to significantly reduce your repayments. Secondly, the way you structure your loan can have an impact as well, or the asset I should say. If you have a tenancy in common structure where you own the majority of it and your partner, if you do have a partner, owns the majority, the minor portion of it, it will mean that all the tax benefits are skewed to you. Also, if you spoke to an accountant, he or she may also suggest that you fill in what's called an income tax variation form. I'm sure it's been covered many times before on this show, Chris, where you're going to be able to get your tax benefits back per pay packet. So often people forget that your tax benefits that are constantly going, your tax that you're going out can be reclaimed per month. A couple of other things you may want to consider as well. Recently, the federal government released a National Rental Affordability Scheme program where if you bought brand new properties that are NRAS qualified, you will get $10,000 per annum for the next 10 years, indexed for 4% per annum. So that's another way to look at investing in areas that have got some strong capital growth. So in summary, there are some really good financing techniques available to you. There is some really good tax advice that you can get to help claim back those tax benefits per pay packet. Okay, and there's also some other more advanced techniques called global limits on lines of credit, and that can be also something you can discuss with your mortgage broker.
Yep. Nicole, any thoughts at all?
Yeah, well, just to touch on, I mean, you make some really good points there, John, just to sort of pick up on the areas that might be suitable. That sort of positively geared property is more likely to be found in outlying areas where the rental demand is strong or in the regions. But of course, when you do go into those areas, you need to make sure that the prospects for growth in those areas are also good, so that there's good industry, there's good job prospects.
Absolutely.
That area is going to continue to grow, and you're going to look at a medium-term price appreciation.
And that's always the debate, isn't it? Because quite often you're either getting yield or growth. It's very,
absolutely,
very hard to get them both.
Yeah, so it's a little bit like the holy grail there in terms of what you are searching for. But if you do your research, it's not to say that it's not out there.
Yeah. And look, Andrew, a few of my thoughts on there. Look, when we did granny flats a few weeks ago, then look, I thought it was absolutely tremendous that you put a $100,000 property into your back garden and you could be getting $300 or $400 a week. Certainly very, very good. It's worth speaking to your broker to see what the individual banks think about that, certainly when it comes back to revaluations, because it will make that property reasonably unique. Certainly when it comes to trying to find areas, Residex, who we have on here quite a bit, they offer reports for about $200 for the highest yield reports and the highest suburbs for capital growth as well. Unfortunately, they don't do one that covers both, but you might be able to buy both reports and see if something comes up on both of those. Another thing that I put into my book is, if you haven't got the cash flow, quite often it is hard to get 6 or 7% rent returns in the inner city where there is capital growth, is you can actually look at drawing more equity out of your property and actually using that as working capital. It's quite a different kind of strategy, it's a different kind of mindset, but certainly that's one way that I actually get the capital growth as well as get kind of not too much negative cash flow. So certainly an idea there. Now, while we're talking about mortgages and some of those options, you've got a few mortgage kind of searching tips we'll pick up on the screen. Do you want to take us through those, John?
Yeah, okay, so we'll see what the graphic goes up now. So the main thing is to start off your search by looking at all the options and understanding what is available to you, what your needs are. So if you are looking for an interest-only loan, make sure that the lender that you're looking for has got that available to you. Shop around. Do not take the first offer that's been given to you. It's an amazing environment at the moment. And look and ask for rate discounts and incentives at the moment. There are some very, very good options available to you if you just ask the question. And be prepared to negotiate with a lender. I often suggest that it's best to stick with your current lender. Perhaps show your current lender an alternative option with another lender, and they will be able to maybe not even match it, but come close to matching it, and therefore it's a little bit more convenient. And then finally, get a mortgage broker to do the work. They will not charge you anything. They do this 8 hours a day, and they will be able to deliver an outcome that should be very satisfactory to you.
Now, and I was talking at the property expo today in Sydney saying outsourcing is the way to go. So if you really want to get out there and try and make a lot of wealth, there's no way you can do everything yourself. You've got to learn to outsource. Anyway, we'll be back in just a minute with Tip of the Week and more questions and ideas on property.
Wouldn't it be great to have a faster, smarter, better way to check any share, any sector, any industry, and know at a glance what to buy, sell, or hold? Welcome to VectorVest Australia. VectorVest ranks the shares you choose on a simple 0-2 scale for value, safety, and timing. VectorVest gives you clear, decisive buy, sell, or hold signals for any share, updated every day. VectorVest makes it easy to go with the winners, avoid the losers, and strengthen your portfolio over time.
If you want some accurate insight to the market, go to the program. It's all there.
It's all right here at VectorVest.com.au. Visit VectorVest.com.au right now to analyze any share free. VectorVest, the faster, smarter, better way to get your portfolio back on track.
Welcome back to the program. Tonight we're joined by John Mansomelli from Mortgage Choice and Nicole Peterson-McKinnon from Smart Investor Magazine. If you've got a question about whether it's the right time to get into the property market or anything to do with financing for properties, then give us a call on 1300 30 34 35 or send us an email to property@skynews.com.au. And now it's time for our viewer tip of the week. And this tip comes from Craig Patberg, and this one really made me smile when I saw it. And he said, don't buy where you'd be afraid to go to pick up the rent. And when making offers, come in low and come up slow. Now, there's often two different trains of thoughts when it comes to picking areas. Some say invest on your own doorstep because then you understand the area and the type of people that would want to buy or rent the property. Then there's the other train of thought that says stay completely unemotional and buy where the financial return is and not where you live necessarily. Now, both strategies have merit and there's plenty of grey area in between. Many of my older clients quite often comment that some of the investments we look at might be too small or they're facing the wrong way, but then I say to them that we're actually targeting the 25 to 35 year old professional demographic and not the 50 or 60 year olds, and so what works for the young people may certainly not work for them. Now, young professionals quite often want the right location and they want something clean and light. Now, there's nothing wrong with a 70 or 80 square metre unit if you're in the inner city, so try and put yourself in the shoes of the renter when choosing investment locations and properties, but do bear in mind that if you're too scared to pick up the rent, so too are most property managers, and if the rent's not coming in, then the bank probably won't like it either. John, I'll jump to you there. Obviously, we're talking people's emotions here, and a lot of people want to buy a property because they can see themselves in there. But in reality, for most people, should they be thinking this way?
Absolutely not. We've often said this on the show, Chris, this is all about the numbers, and you're looking for capital growth in a low-risk environment. Now, from my experience at the coalface, a lot of people feel very comfortable buying in the areas that they live in because that's all they know. However, there may be reasons to suggest that you could be missing out on opportunities where there's some infrastructure developments. So, for example, a brand new hospital, a brand new railway station, and so forth. So those sorts of things are going to accelerate the capital growth that you may be looking for. So I have a classic saying in my practice, so if you want to feel good about yourself, go and see a movie. If you want to make some money, empower yourself with knowledge to make an informed decision.
Yeah, and after a while, you don't need to drive past your property. You should be selling and forgetting. And once you've got enough properties, you'll forget about them anyway.
So.
Yeah, exactly. Nicole, let's have a look at what are some of the latest deals out there. So certainly when it comes to variable rates, what's on offer at the moment? We've got a graphic that will summarise some of those numbers.
Yeah, look, there is a veritable price war going on. John touched on it earlier. And
I love it.
Couldn't be more accurate. I mean, the NAB is breaking up with the big banks, for goodness sakes. I mean, it's just out and out war. So the big bank average is 7.8%. But you can get rates as low as what is on the screen at the moment, which are just tremendous. So talking about a drop of more than 1%, which is just incredible. A lot of these offers you see on the screen here are actually from online lenders, and this is the massive growth in this market, where companies, providers cut out all those overheads, those shop premises, a lot of the staff, transact through the internet or over the phone, and they can really offer a much better deal for you there. Now, just to really bring home the savings that are on offer there, because it can just look like, you know, some nice numbers, but reinforce that with actual dollar figures. If you're looking at a $300,000 mortgage, if you move from the variable rate of a big bank, 7.8%, to a 6.7% rate, as we see on the board there, that's going to save you $213 a month. Over the course of a 25-year loan, that becomes $64,000. But the real power of getting a better deal, of course, when you're talking about your own home rather than an investment, is if you keep paying the same that you're already paying, where you're going to save an additional $75,000. So it's well worth, anyone who thinks it's not worth picking up the phone and getting a better deal, you're talking figures that are absolutely enormous.
And that's the personal discipline of just budgeting, to say that if you've been paying $1,000 a month or $2,000 a month, just carry on paying that, get a cheaper deal, and still do it.
I mean, I firmly believe you should never decrease your mortgage repayments on your own home. You should keep them at that same level and just chip away at that debt faster. You want that non-deductible debt gotten rid of.
Now, a lot of people wouldn't recognise the names on the screen there. Does that make a difference?
Yeah, look, they don't. Some of those names on the screen are actually backed by bigger banks, though. And again, it's just that they've decided that they can launch this online arm that, again, doesn't have the overheads to try and capitalise on this very fast burgeoning market. The regulation is the same. And let's face it, if you're looking at a situation where you owe someone money, you're not as concerned about, their reliability as if they owe you money. Or
my dad always taught me that, is if you owe the money and they go bust, then that's their problem, not yours.
Absolutely.
And they typically don't recall the loan. So a couple of my banks in the UK have gone bust, but it just gets sold on to another bank.
Sold on to somebody,
yeah. You don't have to suddenly pay back your whole mortgage most of the time.
So probably the biggest risk you face in that situation is that the loan book is sold and the interest rate is increased. But the tremendous development in Australia now is that exit fees are from July 1 banned. So in theory, mortgages are very mobile, so you should be able to just get out of that mortgage quite easily and go to a more competitive rate once again.
Now, obviously some people want to get into the fixed rate deals. If you can't sleep at night, obviously save time to go and fix. What are some of the deals? And again, we'll pull them up on the screen.
Yeah, the fixed rates, as John touched on before as well, are very good. You're looking at a lot of fixed rates that are just about the 7% mark there, which is very good. But you did see before that the variable rates on offer are lower. Now, I've got a couple of reservations about fixed rates in general. When you take out a fixed rate, you are really betting against the bank, and the bank has teams of people crunching the numbers and really making sure that they're going to make a profit on this. So it is a real leap of faith betting against the bank or the house, if you like. So really, I would advocate only ever fixing half of a mortgage if you really do want that repayment certainty, and only if you can get a deal that is significantly below what you're already paying. So just be a little cautious there. Also, don't fix for more than 3 years, because I mean, we've already discussed how quickly interest rate expectations can change, even in the space of a month. 2 weeks. So you don't want to tie yourself in. I've had so many people on the phone to me over the past year or so, just in a desperate situation because they locked in when the rate rises just became too uncomfortable pre-GFC at that 9.5% level, and there was no getting out of that without massive break costs. And you know, when rates fell dramatically, that was just so difficult.
And let's not forget fixed rates as well
are very inflexible. So a lot of the lenders will not allow you to pay more than $20,000 a year. Yeah. So you may be in a fortunate position to be able to pay more than that, and all of a sudden that loan becomes very expensive. And even if you put $20,000 a year extra into it, you may not be able to redraw that money out. So be
careful. So especially a couple of days ago when they're talking about interest rates rising, you might have gone and fixed in, and then suddenly they talk about a 0.5% drop, and that's a lot of money.
That's right, exactly. You need to be very careful with fixed rates, in my opinion.
Yeah. Now, Nicole mentioned about exit fees, John. A lot of people thought that's a great thing because we're saving money, but a lot of the mortgage industry thought it was actually could be actually a bad thing.
Yeah, that was an interesting scenario. We were very concerned that what this was going to do was, on a silver platter, hand mortgage customers to the big four. The reason is the smaller banks are very reliant on various fees to recoup upfront costs. So whilst the government had some really good intentions, we still feel in the industry that they haven't really understood how funding mechanisms work. And so on a silver platter, the big four banks have essentially received the Australian consumer market in a way that is in their favour. So the intentions were good, but the delivery of it was poorly executed or poorly thought out. And I'm really worried about these smaller lenders coming through who have got different funding mechanisms to the bigger banks, who can't recoup those initial upfront costs.
So Nicole, I'm sure you've done some stories on it as well.
Yeah, we have indeed. We've been following this one really closely. And it's really interesting because the non-bank lenders were what introduced competition into the marketplace and really forced mortgage margins down a decade or more ago. And the way they did that was with these exit fees, which were, you know, very punitive, they really were, but they were only incurred if you left within a, say, 3 to 5 year period. So after that, you were home and hosed and you were free to leave. But that's the way that they could keep their interest rates really quite low. Yeah. So that was all built into the pricing mechanism, as you say, John. Yeah. Take that away and they have to change their products around the edges to actually recoup that money. So on July 1, we did see quite a bit of kind of fringe tweaking of additional application fees, legal fees, valuation fees come in among the smaller lenders, and also interest rates in a couple of cases also just shoot up as well. And of course, as soon as one moves, the rest can increase, and that's where the competition disappears and the big banks do start to dominate
again. The big banks.
Absolutely.
And that's why it's not always as simple as you read in the papers at times.
Unfortunately.
Now, when it comes to choosing a mortgage, John, you've got a couple of tips. Again, we'll pull up on the screen so the viewers can see the summary. Okay. I think the first was to really just not only understand your current needs, but obviously the future needs as well.
Yeah, so let's give an example of one of your viewers that are watching. They have a plan to develop a portfolio of properties. So one lender that you may have seen on TV has got a very attractive interest rate, but they're not going to take 100% of the rental income. So all of a sudden your borrowing capacity's dropped. So don't forget, look at your entire needs holistically, okay? So look at the entire way that the bank is going to look at the way they assess you. Don't set and forget, meaning look at your interest rate regularly, your requirements. Do you need to move from interest only to principal interest? Do you need to have a redraw facility and so forth? The home loan health check is very important. If you go back 2 years ago when you took out a loan, how much has your life changed or your aspirations changed? So I would argue that a home loan health check as a minimum should be done 2 years, ideally every 12 months. Now consider refinancing, particularly in this sort of market. You'd be amazed at what you can get if you ask the question. There, your own lender right now would be doing deals that you may not be aware of, and you can pick up the phone through your mortgage broker, obviously, who can do all that work for you. And then finally, consider the differences between fixed and variable. The fixed will give you security that you're looking for, as Nicole pointed out, but the downside is that apart from the rates going down, you may be limited to how much extra you can put into the loan, and also you may not have flexibility to pull out any extra repayments. Variable rate loans, obviously if rates go up, it's going to mean that there's going to be some issues regarding repayments, but you can pay extra. All up, I'd ask you to consider talking to a mortgage broker. They'll be able to go through these sorts of things with you, both in the short term and your future needs.
Sure. Some good advice there. Now, Nicole, is it in your current issue, this recent article?
That's right.
So we're saying there's a bit of a changing property market at the moment. There's some ways to exploit that. Do you want to tell us a bit more about the article?
Yeah, absolutely. So we've been following this story about 4 or 5 months ago. We ran a cover that was property, why prices will fall. So we did a report on nearly 700 suburbs around the country and identified 141 suburbs where prices in real terms were going to fall. And we've seen that borne out to the extent where people are now starting to see bargains, opportunities creeping into the market. We've actually surveyed our readers and financial review readers for this current story, and we've found that a quarter of them view the downturn as an opportunity to buy a bigger property. One third see it as an opportunity to get a better location, and 52% believe it gives them the ability to negotiate a better deal. And that's the kind of activity we're seeing savvy buyers engage in right now.
And it's a good thing you talk about that, because everyone is getting a bit depressed, and we keep talking about it on the show, and people say, "Oh, you're too happy on the show, and you're too positive." But most of the people that do come on the show as guests do genuinely believe that there's opportunities, and it's not a bad time.
Yeah, look, and that's the thing with the investor psychology of any market, whether it's property, whether it's shares. Too often, you see retail investors get in at the top.